Welcome to our third installment of Johannes Brahms' Ein Deutsches Requiem. We turn now to the second movement, abbreviated here as Aber, but whose full title is actually Denn alles Fleisch ist wie Gras, or in English, For all mankind, or all flesh, is like grass. My name is Dr. Ted Hain. I'm a bass chorister in the Sacramento Choral Society and Orchestra. The SCSO will be performing the Brahms Deutsches Requiem again this spring, March 23rd, 2019 at 8 p.m. in the Sacramento Community Theater. As we have been preparing to rehearse this marvelous work, I have been reading books and listening to podcasts about Brahms and his world. Also, I've been talking with other choristers about their experience with the Brahms Requiem. I can truthfully say that every musician I have interviewed, when asked about their relationship with the German Requiem, universally assume a pleasant look on their face and typically say, I remember when I first sang the Brahms Requiem. And they remember it fondly. If you ask choristers about, say, the Verdi Requiem or Mozart or even the Rutter Requiem, you'll get a range of reactions. Some might love the work, others may be somewhat blasé or even negative about this or that aspect of the given work. But everyone seems to have a warm spot in their heart for Ein Deutsches Requiem. In this video, we're going to look at three aspects of the second movement. First, we're going to look at some of Brahms' melodic threads, some of the commonalities that go throughout his works. Second, we're going to look at the text, or the real message, of the second movement. And lastly, we're going to end with a few little, what I call, rehearsal tips. Melodically, we could spend an entire hour just looking at various interconnections in Brahms' music. We won't do that, but I hope you'll indulge me with one last musical comparison. Let's take this just ein bisschen further. First, remember the ascending fourths of the Selig Sint motif in the first movement and their relationship to the descending fourths of the second movement instrumental introduction line. Selig sind, selig sind. And the second movement. Note the five notes used here. Well, now I'd like to add another Brahms melodic line. One that isn't from the Requiem at all. Specifically, let's play the Brahms lullaby. Same five notes used again. But before you conclude that I'm going too far afield here, allow me to jump briefly forward to the fifth movement of the Requiem. The fifth is widely considered to be a lullaby sung by Brahms' dearly departed mother to her son, to Brahms. She sings, I will see you again, or Ich will euch Wiedersehen. Ich will euch wiedersehen. Again, the same five notes. Finally, allow me to play all these four melodic lines together. Selig sind. Second movement. the lullaby. And the fifth movement. Back to Selig. All with the same five notes. Now, I don't think Brahms did this by calculation, but I'm personally convinced that there are harmonies and intervals that Brahms likes, and therefore musical ideas that he uses, modifies, and then reuses, all of which gives us, the audience, the feeling of, this is Brahms. Now let's move to the libretto, or the message of the second movement of Brahms' German Requiem. The second movement is really one of the strongest parts of the entire work. It's probably the first movement that Brahms actually wrote, as he most likely began it back when Robert Schumann first died, nearly a decade before he actually published the German Requiem. At that time, it may have been conceived as a single piece, possibly a Trauermarsch or a funeral march. The second movement provides a complete logical progression, including all of Brahms' three questions, woher, warum, and wohin. It starts with a somber funeral march, builds to a peak with the resounding aber pivot point, and then concludes with a joyous victory march in the form of Brahms' first of three fugues. So conceptually, this one movement is sort of a mini synopsis of the message of the entire Requiem. Brahms turns to the New Testament for our libretto, reading from the first letter of Peter, chapter 1, verse 24. This is the text that Brahms uses. Denn alles Fleisch ist wie Gras und alle Herrlichkeit der Menschen wie des Grases Blume. Das Gras ist verdorret und die Blume abgefallen. Brahms uses these two sentences in their entirety, which in English translate to, for all flesh is like grass, and all the beauty of mankind like the grass's flower. The grass withers, and the flower falls down. Brahms takes this one complete verse with both sentences intact and moves it into a crescendo, starting at pianissimo and building to a mezzo forte. But he's not done yet. He takes the entire line, duplicates it, and starts over again, but this time beginning at a mezzo forte and building to a powerful forte point. He connects these two repetitions with a marvelous orchestral bridge in between. Now, obviously, the setting is a bit more complex than two straight lines. Really, he gives us two arcs of verse 24 of 1 Peter 1. Denn alles Fleisch. The first arc is quietly compelling, and the second one strongly urgent. Let's listen to the first arc. It begins somberly, but with a building tension gradually. It's considered a march, but it's actually written in 3/4 time, which you think of as a waltz. When we get to the second sentence, das Gras ist verdorret, we can feel more of the dance. Then in the second arc, Brahms repeats the line emphatically. Before we move forward, let's listen to the stirring instrumental crescendo that Brahms gives us to bridge these two arcs. So there we have this structure that Brahms chooses then to repeat the double arc structure. He duplicates it entirely. At the end of each double arc, though, he leaves us hanging with a big question mark. The text at these points is incomplete. The music pauses. The chords are unresolved. He's told us about the frailty of our flesh. We've been forewarned that we will all wither and fail. After the first double arch, he changes keys from minor back to major and moves from the agricultural analogy of grass and flowers to another agricultural metaphor from the Epistle of James, the 5th chapter and the 7th verse. Here he counsels us to be patient. So seid nun geduldig. Like a farmer, ein Ackermann, who waits patiently for the harvest. Recall back in the first Selig Sint movement, Brahms read from Psalms 126, where we sang, Die mit Tränen säen, or those who sow in tears shall reap in joy. So here again, we read that the good farmer must wait patiently after sowing his seed till the harvest comes, the harvest of die köstliche Frucht der Erde, the valuable fruit of the earth. So, till then, he counsels us to seid geduldig, remain patient. But Brahms isn't done with us yet. He dives back into his second double arc, again presenting our mortal dilemma, alles Fleisch ist wie Gras, building softly in the first arc again, a crescendo in the orchestral interlude, and again plays a second forte arc. Once again, he leaves us hanging, unresolved, questioning, what now, Herr Brahms? Watch von Karajan take us from the hanging point to the climactic resolution. He finishes the second of the second arcs, and then big pause. Up to now, for 190 measures, everything was woher, describing our current condition. Now, however, Brahms moves us from woher to warum, with the climactic aber des Herrn Wort bleibet, but the Lord's word endures. Interesting that Brahms says this loudly, but only once. Enough said. In the original Greek, the written word actually came with no punctuation, no underlining, no caps. These languages have no structured way to suggest emotion or emphasis of any sort. Now, when we translate those languages to English or German, the scribes added punctuation, and verse numbering, but really very little else. I'm going to suggest that if Brahms were the author of these verses using modern customs, I think Brahms would have put verse 25 now in all caps. He would have underlined it, added an exclamation point, and if he could, he would have highlighted it with magic marker. This is the effect that he gives us musically when he moves from verse 24 to verse 25. I love how Brahms uses these scriptures largely intact. He doesn't pick a word from one book and mix it with a couple words from another chapter. He instead quotes intact biblical messages in their context, but as a composer of music, he uses the power of melody and rhythm and dynamics to take us from the somber message of verse 24 to the explosive message at the aber das Wort Gott bleibet. This is not random. Brahms is telling us, listen up, people, this is important. This is our raison d'etre. So Brahms has taken 195 measures to expound on verse 24 and to build up to this high point. He repeats the Denn alles Fleisch statement four times in this build-up before he reaches the climax. But at the climax, at the aber point, he uses a mere nine measures of double forte, stating the obvious once, aber des Herrn Wort bleibet. He then follows that by 130 measures of fugal celebration, declaring that the redeemed shall return with shouts of joy, ewige Freude, repeated over and over. We're going to consider the structure of fugues more in our next chapter, where we explore the third movement. But it's important to note that fugues tend to lose their power and fall apart if performers are not careful, number one, to keep pace, but also if they do not use superb diction. Dr. Kendrick is forever trying to get us to not produce, for example, R's like a pirate, or an American for that matter. No R. Instead, we are told to roll all your R's. We are to sing Freude and werden and wieder, and to spit out every consonant, D, da, leid, tragen, ewige Freude, wie das Gras. But rather than try to go through each consonant or pronunciation rule here, allow me to show you how real German singers do this. Don't worry that you might be overdoing it. Spit it out. Roll your R's. Über-enunciate your umlauts. There's no chance that you are overdoing it. So, in the second movement, we have hit one of Brahms' big high points, his Warum declaration of Aber des Herrn Wort bleibet. And we've seen the first of Brahms' three great fugal celebrations. Come back soon and we'll consider the third movement, where Brahms mesmerizes us with the Ich hoffe and climaxes with what I judge to be the best of his three fugues. These videos are hosted at youtube.com/Ted Hain. Subscribe to the channel to receive notifications of new chapters when they are posted. I welcome your comments and your feedback.